Hello, Stacy Campbell here of Shiloh Global, and tonight we have one of our favorite people, Wesley and I, our dear friends with Brian and Candace Simmons, whom we've known for 20 years. We've served on apostolic team of HIM together. We've just done so many fun things together over the years, and we so honor you, Brian, and thank you very, very much for coming on What the Spirit is Saying to the Church series. I want to preface this by saying that, you know, we are doing this series to prepare the church for this new era. And we've had a number of different people, Bible scholars, prophets, leaders, worship leaders, each giving their part of the story of what God is saying, how to mobilize the church in this new era, because everything is very different since COVID struck. And we will get into that, because COVID personally struck you in a very big way. We are going to get into that in a minute. But first of all, you know, you are the author of the Passion Translation. You were a missionary for years. You were with New Frontiers Missions, was it, or New Tribes?
New Tribes, yeah.
New Tribes Missions, and you translated the Bible to an unreached people group, and you have, and you've been a pastor of an apostolic center, and you've seen revival. You've lived 10 lives, you and Candace. It's incredible all the things that you've done. But I want you to kind of highlight some of the things that you're doing now, and people can listen to your conversion podcast on the conversion podcast series that we're doing as well off of our Shiloh Global podcast series from Charisma Podcast Network, or with the Healing Rooms of the Santa Maria Valley. There's just a number of places, Stacy Campbell News, you can hear your real history. But tell us right now what you're doing and how the Lord has led you into doing what you're doing.
Well, thank you very much, Stacy. We love you and Wesley. You're incredible champions of the faith, and we followed your ministry so closely over the years, and we're just thrilled to be a part of your lives. And thank you again for being on this show. So yeah, what I'm doing right now is I'm translating the Bible. I mean, who does that? That's just really nuts. That's crazy. I had a divine call in 2009 after pastoring 18 years. The Lord really led us to step aside from the pastoral. And I was asking God, what do you have for us to do? And in a very divine way, he made it clear that I was to do this translation project. He promised he would help me, that he would be with me, that it would touch the nations and would bring life to many, many people. So I've been involved with that now for 12 years and working about every day, virtually every day. Today, I'm in chapter 11 of Daniel. I'm doing Daniel chapter 11.
Wow.
So fascinating. What I'm learning from the book of Daniel, I feel like I'm getting a little bit of a primer course on world history going through Daniel, because the prophecies given in the book of Daniel are so profound and so far-reaching. Anybody that doesn't believe that God can speak about the future, you need to read the book of Daniel, because it's just crazy. But that's what we've been doing. We travel some, very little now with COVID, and Candace and I write books together and minister together. We've been married, it'll be 50 years this December, and we've got a family and grandchildren, three great-grandchildren, and just full-time grandparents in one sense. So we love that. We love our family like you do, like everyone listening loves your family. But it's especially what we just went through. If I could just briefly mention my somewhat near-death experience I had this year, contracting COVID early this year in January. And for 2 months, I was really struggling with this disease. It hit me hard. I was in bed for a month, didn't leave the house for, I think, a month, except to go to the emergency room, and had a couple of nights where I wondered if I would see the morning. And it just was so heart, you know, rending to be able to look at your life and at the end of it. And yet now I feel like I'm raised from the dead, because God has healed me of the pneumonia. I still have scar tissue, but, and I know I'm speaking to many people that have also been affected powerfully by COVID. You may be listening and you have a loved one that has passed or is even now suffering with it. So let me tell you, I can identify with you, dear friend. And it's something that, you know, God gives us an opportunity in every situation to draw closer to Him. I have learned that anything that brings me closer to God is a blessing. And I want to milk the blessings out of this problem, this episode that I've gone through. I feel like I'm on the the other side. I've crossed over that River Jordan, so to speak. But the lessons that I've learned, some of them I'm still processing. Number one, my family. That's really all you really have at the hour of your death. It's not your achievements, not your gifts, not a book you've written, not how big of mailing list you may have. It's really the loved ones that you give your life to, and they poured their life into you. And I can tell you, in those dark days when I was wondering if I was going to see my way through it, that all I really cared about was my family. And my wife, Candace, is, I actually wondered, is she an angel? I mean, she is so supernaturally pure. She's like Snow White to me in every way. She even looks like that at a costume party. She even dressed up like Snow White one time. And it was
we have to pause here for a moment because, you know, I don't think people understand how close you came to dying. You had COVID, but many people have had COVID, some to lesser and some to greater degrees. Wesley and I just finished having COVID, but ours was a very mild case. But you ended up with quadruple pneumonia. You had viral and bacterial pneumonia in both lungs twice over, four different kinds of pneumonia. Or explain to me, how serious was it medically?
Well, you know, your lungs, you can't live if your lungs don't function. And my lungs were filling with fluid, and I had bacterial pneumonia, which is fairly easy, at least in my case, it was fairly easy to get rid of. They gave me horse pills that were so potent, in 5 days I was over it. I mean, that's how strong they were, antibiotics. Wow. But with the viral pneumonia, they can't really do anything. It just has to be God who really kicks in your immune system and activates healing. And he did that for me. So yeah, that was a dangerous thing. Not being able to breathe is kind of spooky. You feel like you have a pillow over your mouth the whole time and you're not able to get a decent breath of air. But the Lord kept me from, long-term in the hospital, which I'm thankful for. And I feel better. I'm getting better. I'm out walking. I'm enjoying this new lease on life. Stacey, it's really being born again for me. So wow. It's changed me in so many ways and tenderized my heart to others and to those that hurt and those that suffer. And I think God's going to raise up some tenderhearted lovers in these days to come.
Wow. I know Candace is one of the most incredible women. And, you know, one thing I've always loved about you and Candace is you've just always been infatuated with her. It's like it never gets old with you. And to hear that when you face death, you literally face death. Candace told me there was a night or two there where they weren't sure if you were going to make it through. You couldn't breathe. And I know my daughter, when she was first born, she contracted viral pneumonia, RSV, when she was less than a month old. And the pediatrician looked at me and said, we had a baby die of this last year. It's fatal. It can be fatal before 3 months old. He put a 24-hour nurse on her. He put, they put her in a little ventilator. And it's serious. Viral pneumonia can be very serious because it's untreatable, like you said. And so in those moments, and I think you have an incredible perspective on what the Spirit is saying to the church now. And as you said, family is important. And we've had several prophetic people on this program saying it's family. It's family. It's family. And even at the healing rooms today, the prophetic word comes out again, it's family. And so can you talk to us about, because what intensified, because you've always loved your family, you've always loved your wife, what intensified in this experience going into the new about family?
Yeah, it's the values of your heart get shifted away from the temporal, because family, you know, for me, family is forever. Now, I've heard some prophets say that in heaven, husband and wife don't get to live together. And I'm brokenhearted over that. And I'm asking God to make an exception for Brian and Candace, that we would be the breaker couple to actually get to live together for eternity, because we would love that. We enjoy each other's company. And yeah, so family, those values move and shift from the cardboard, the plastic, to the tangible substance of love relationships. And if you think about it, that's what family really is. It's that love relationship that time doesn't diminish. It only strengthens and grows. It only deepens. And the longing I felt in those lowest moments of my life was that I could be with family, and I wanted to impact them. Stacey, I wanted to leave a legacy. I thought about what I could leave my kids. And of course I want to leave an inheritance. Every dad wants to do that for their children. But I wanted a legacy of love, memories of dad and granddad that loved them when they went through their hard times. So it renewed my commitment to put my family first. And regretfully, that's not always been the case of my life, but it is now. With God's help, God helping me.
Wow.
Take our stand.
So, you know, sometimes, you know, we've had all these different speakers on what the Spirit is saying to the church in the new era, but some things are just eternal. Some things never change. They just get deeper and deeper and deeper. And as I've said, that the Godhead itself is family. It's Father,
yeah.
Son, Holy Spirit, the feminine, the male and female, in his own image created he them there. It's all part of who he is, that's eternal. That's part of who he is. So what else has God been speaking to you in? I feel like you have this more burning perspective, and it's, you know, you are the author of the Passion Translation. You've always been full of passion. And anybody who's ever read the Passion Translation understands it differently. People are always quoting it wherever, all the meetings I'm at, people say, and the Passion Translation says, and the Passion Translation puts it this way, because there is an understanding that even prior to this life and death experience, God gave you about his love letter, you always call it, his intention of love for the world. So what else did he tell you? What else is the Spirit saying?
Well, yeah, I jotted down some thoughts that I've had since the beginning of this year and through what I've gone through, and even more recently in the last few days. The one word that was very top of my list is the word perseverance. Now, we all hear, you know, different things from God, and like you've already mentioned, that not one person has the whole picture, but that's the word I'm hearing. And I found it interesting that what took mankind beyond our planet and our moon was a Mars rover called Perseverance. And I just think it was prophetic when that landed safely, and, you know, they're actually have microphones on it and they're hearing the sounds from Mars. I mean, out of this world, literally. And I think what takes us beyond the limitations and boundaries of our lives is perseverance. And perseverance is simply faithfulness in doing difficult things, even if success is delayed, even if the desired outcome seems far from you. That perseverance, I guess the fruit of the Spirit is long suffering. And I wonder if that wouldn't be a synonym, that to persevere in difficulty. And I never really felt like giving up when I was 2 months with this ordeal. I never really felt like giving up, but I knew that if I persevered, I might be healed, you know.
Wow.
And I want to say I might be healed, because my faith was starting to get dim when you're unable to breathe and you feel like you're underwater. It, you know, we'll just see how all of the rest of us do, you know. It was difficult. But I knew that if I would cling, if I would hold tightly, if I would not quit and give up, perseverance is a virtue. And I believe the Lord is really saying to all our listeners here today that wherever you are, whatever you're going through, it's not going to last forever. Jesus is the one yesterday, today, and forever, not your pain, not your mess or difficulty. It doesn't say difficulties are yesterday, today, and forever, but Jesus is. And to fasten our heart on that perseverance of the Lord Jesus. I mean, think about him in the Garden of Gethsemane, carrying a cross, stumbled beneath the weight of that cross. He opened his palm to our nails. That perseverance that led that man, the Lord Jesus Christ, I say man with a capital M, but that led him to give his life. No one could take it from him. He gave it willingly. Man, the perseverance and faithfulness for his Father, doing what he saw the Father doing every day, putting Father knows best, Father first in his life. And that example of perseverance is just stirring me in this hour. And I want to be faithful. I think perseverance it's like a goal line stance. And for American football, you know what I'm talking about. You're on the goal line. You're just about, you know, the quarterback could almost leap over the pile and make the touchdown. But to live our lives at that goal line stance, that we're always persevering, ready for success, breakthrough, the next victory to hit us. And to quit is just not going to be in my vocabulary. I remember being in track in high school, and I was not a good runner. I was not super athletic. And I remember a 1 mile race that I came in last. But let me tell you, I came in.
Come on.
I finished that race. And I saw everybody pass me. I saw everybody go ahead. And I said, I'm not going to quit. And the coach even noticed. He said, well, at least you finished, son. I said, well, that's the key. And I want you to finish. I want every one of you listening here today, finish what God has set before you. And I think at the end of your life, you'll look back and say, I'm glad I stuck to my marriage. I'm glad I stuck to my principles. I'm glad I stuck to the values that really brought life to me, faith, hope, and the joy that we always have in Jesus Christ. So persevere, my friend, and take a lesson from the Mars rover. If you want to go where no one's gone before, you got to persevere.
That's awesome. And, you know, even in Daniel 12, as I pray the Bible, as you know, I've prayed the Bible since I was 16 years old, and now I'm 60 years old. But the one thing that always strikes me about Daniel 12 are those two characteristics that come up, and Jesus alludes to it as well. And he said, and Daniel says, in a time of distress such as the world has never known, you're almost in Daniel 12, you know, those who have insight, and those who lead many to righteousness, those who have insight, and the one who endures past 45 days longer there's numbers like 1245 to 1300 and whatever. Anyway, there's a few days longer. It's even in those times of distress, the one who endures, he who endures to the end will be saved. And as we all know, no one has had more perseverance for humanity than God himself. He keeps enduring through all of our sins and all of the ups and downs, and he just never quits. And like you said, Jesus on the cross, that's huge. But I really do think that perseverance is one of the key attributes that people are going to have for the new era, because everything is going to be new. Some of it will be good new, some of it will be bad new. Things are changing rapidly. There will be, you know, many, many changes. There are already many, many changes. And sometimes we haven't caught up with how rapidly the world and even the nations are changing right now. So perseverance, that's a great word. What else did the Lord show you, Brian?
Yeah, I have some things that are somewhat prophetic in that, you know, and it may be repetition. You may have heard these words before from other prophets or other leaders that are really hearing what the Lord's saying and are speaking those messages. But prophetically, I feel like we're going to have some a wave of supernatural spontaneous healings in our meetings, and we're going to experience divine healings like never before. And we're getting the sprinkling of that, the early raindrops, you know, the early rain is coming, but you wait until the thunderclouds really build and we get the gully washer, we get the downpour. And we're going to see even what we, you know, you look back at Oral Roberts, you know, some of the old faith healing ministries that filled tents with tens of thousands, that's going to be commonplace in days to come. Not just the tents, but I think coliseums and meeting places, even fields, and the open fields like Woodstock, you know, not necessarily just music, but this wave of healing is going to bring new leaders, new teaching about healing, new divine insights about walking in the healing power of God, and without the celebrity attached to it. In other words, we're going to find, you know, people out of, you know, the backwoods, they're going to suddenly rise up with such a ministry of power and healings that it's going to startle us. Like, where did you get this? Well, from divine presence, from divine encounters, and from a touch of coal of fire on my hands. That's where I got it. And there's going to be women and men and young people. They're going to carry this powerful anointing of supernatural, spontaneous healings. That's the three words I got.
That's incredible. Supernatural, spontaneous healings. Like, that's incredible. It's as though you were in our healing room meeting this morning. Lori Taylor got up and said, virtually those things verbatim. She quoted John Wimber and said, you know, in the early days of the Vineyard, we would go down to Anaheim and John Wimber would be sitting there and he would say this statement over and over again, everyone can play. Meaning everybody's going to be involved. And we've been promised all this divine healing, supernatural, spontaneous healing. And everything you just said, she said this morning and Rick said this morning. And we were waiting in the presence of God. Like, is it now, Lord? But he's in the pregnant pause right now. He's in the waiting because it's going to happen. That's incredible.
Yeah. And, you know, moving to another point here, for years, if you've been around me in any meetings I've done, man, I am so for this generation. I'm so for the young, equipping them, raising them up. We had Lou and I and Dutch Sheets did the first Nazarite conference. It was at our church. And we had young people.
You have always been a radical. You've always been a radical.
But here's the deal. I feel like the Lord is now saying this about the gray hairs of the old timers. And because we love Stacy, we're going to say 60 and above. We're going to see a first love turning. That's the word he gave me. A first love turning of my generation, the boomers, coming back into that Jesus movement, first love, where we just cared about one thing and it's making Jesus known, to evangelize, to tell the gospel, which piggybacks onto another word I have about speak up. The Lord is saying, speak up. I mean, come on, speak up. When Joel 2:28 says that when the Holy Spirit comes and falls upon a generation, they're going to speak up. Speaking the word of God boldly is always a move, is always a fruit of the moving of the Holy Spirit. So one of the true signs of revival is you're going to see people get their voice back. You know, I wouldn't be surprised that Bob Sorge supernaturally gets healed. Wow. To get his voice back as a sign from God in the days to come. But we're going to find women getting a voice. You know, we're in an era. It's so clear. You've got to be blind not to see the anointing coming upon women right now. The power of God falling upon women, and we're going to shatter forever, once and for all, the teaching that, you know, go home, that women don't have a place, that they're not ready or they're not meant to lead or this or that. And God is going to raise up a holy band of women. Great will be the company that will proclaim it and broadcast that message. And we're going to see some of the tremendous workers of God in this coming era are women. And part of this is they have been muffled. They have not been speaking up. Even with the sexual abuse issue that is being uncovered everywhere in culture, politics especially, that women have not spoken up, and they need to. And we all need to. When we see evil around us, when we see abuse or harm coming to children or to anyone, the disenfranchised, people of another race, we need to speak up. We can't stay silent anymore. So the Lord is really saying it's time to speak up for justice and righteousness.
Wow, that's really good. And be bold. And I think that's part of the move out of the church. I remember when the Holy Spirit fell on us, we were Baptists and David Russo was with us. We were cessationists. We didn't believe in prophecy or healing or any of those things. And one of the first things that God said, he came on us, filled us with the Holy Spirit, just like Acts 2. Literally, we were shaking, trembling, etc. And God began to speak prophetically through David Roos, and he said, "Let me out of the back room. Let me out of the back room." And it was one of the things that, of a boldness, of speaking up, of not being silent about what God is saying and doing. So that's incredible. And we all need to be reminded, because we get settled. We just settle, and it's time to be bold.
You know, I feel like the word of God being preached and taught and spoken, I think we've kind of been in a famine spiritually, in a way. And that famine is being broken because people are falling in love with the Bible. And I know I've got the Passion Translation. I know all of that. And I'm not trying to sound self-serving, honestly, in saying this. I don't care what Bible you read, but read it and live it. And I'm seeing a generation rise up. And you know what they're wanting, Stacey? They want not the superficial anymore. They want the profound. Give us the mysteries of our faith. Give us the reality, the meat I can sink my teeth into. And you know, that focus on the Word of God. The Bible says that the Word of God is a two-mouth sword. That's in Hebrews chapter 4. That it's a two-mouth sword. It isn't two-edged. That's how it's been translated. But as I put in my footnote, it's a two, literally a two-mouth sword. When the word comes from God's mouth through our mouth, it suddenly becomes that two-mouth sword. And it can pierce, it can uncover, it can deal with issues, and it can fulfill the purpose of God. But it has to come through our mouth to become that two-mouth sword. God spoke and created. So there is a creative power in the words we speak, and that we've got to speak in alignment with God. We don't speak out of fantasies. We don't come up with some wild imagination and, you know, we're suddenly going to, "Lord, take me to Maui this moment on the beach." No, that's not it. We speak God's word, and you can't do that if you don't know it. So this turning back to the Word of God and getting our doctrines from the Scripture, not from contemporary culture that is always going to fight God's truth. It's always going to limit, dilute, and distract us from the edginess of the truth of God. But to find the Bible as our source and our foundation of hope and life, and become prisoners of hope again, and to get back into that glorious place of loving Jesus and his word like never before, returning to first love. Hebrews, by the way, I'm doing an online study group, a live online group. And if anybody wants to join it, you can just go to passionandfire.com/Hebrews Live, Hebrews Live, and sign up. Passionandfire.com, Candace is passion, I'm fire, and then .com/Hebrews Live. And it's every Thursday evening. We just do a live group, and we have 300 or 400 people live every week, and we're going verse by verse. It's deep, folks. We only spend about 45 minutes, 30 to 45 minutes, but we take them a deep dive into the truths of the book of Hebrews. People are loving it. And I hope some of your friends will jump in, but that desire for depth and to get out of shallow, celebrity, superficial, looking good, the hipster look is about to shift into a godly glow. If you are anointed, you don't have to worry about what you're wearing, because you're wearing the garment of Christ. And that look is the look of the future. It's the glow of the anointing of God that's going to emerge. Daniel 12, verse 3, shining ones are coming. They will shine with the presence of God. Moses had his face shine, but you wait until you get a light of glory beaming on that person that you've never met before, but suddenly is walking in that thin place between heaven and earth and releasing glory into meetings and into the people's lives. So, yeah.
You know, Brian, I just have to stop because you've always been passionate for the word. You started out as a Bible translator in an unreached people group, living in the jungle in like tents and canoeing and, you know, really raw, no electricity, none of that. But you were translating the Bible in to a tribe that hadn't had the Bible in their own language, and you've always been passionate for the word. But you're saying that it's time to go even deeper and deeper and deeper. Now you're still a Bible translator, making a modern English version, illuminating not just the language but the heart behind the words.
Yeah.
And I wonder, in your life death experience, did you have Bible verses running through your head? Was the Bible coming alive to you? And did you have anything like that where the word itself was impacting you?
Oh yeah. Worship or reading the Bible, just, you know, a sentence, if somebody would just speak that over me, and they did. I had hundreds of people, thousands perhaps, that prayed and left messages, even wrote song for my healing and sent it to me. I mean, it's just unbelievable. But yeah, the scriptures, they really are the manna, the hidden manna that we hide in our heart, and it feeds us, you know, in these times of loneliness or times of pain or hurt or confusion. We feed from what's in us. And if you've just been filled with anxiety and cares, you can't really hear the voice of the Lord and the word of the Lord. But if you fill your heart with the word of God in those dry times, in the difficult times, you've got a source to come back to. You have a well that opens up and feeds you and quenches your thirst. And yeah, I did experience that. Sure did.
Oh, wow, that's amazing. So that is what the Spirit is saying. Get into the Word of God. And those of you who are already in it, go deeper in the Word of God. Find Him there. He wants to reveal even more of Himself to you at this time. And so any final thoughts, Brian, of what the Spirit is saying? Just go for it.
Yeah, there's twice in the book of Hebrews, and I'm kind of saturated with Daniel and Hebrews right now, but twice in the book of Hebrews, we have this looking unto Jesus. You have it in chapter 12, and that's a very familiar verse to most of us, you know, looking away unto Jesus, the author and completer of faith and every virtue. But there's another scripture in Hebrews 2, where it speaks about all things are under His feet, and He's given us dominion to rule, and He is over all things. And then it has this strange saying. It says, but we don't yet see all things under His feet, but we see Jesus. And to me, it's like when you don't see things the way you want it, we see Jesus. We turn our eyes away. We focus on Him. And that's what I had to do that, Stacey. And I didn't want to be, nobody wants to go through COVID or wants to go through relationship tensions and stuff like that. But if we don't see what we want, we have what we want, and we see Jesus. So that Jesus focus came back to me in a very powerful way. And I want to release that to everybody today. I want all of us to get back to the heart of worship, which is Jesus Christ. We don't see everything under our feet, but we see Jesus. Now, we can be triumphant. We can proclaim, everything's under my feet. I'm going to crush it all under my feet. Well, but we don't see it that way yet. But we do see Jesus. And in time, He will crush Satan under our feet. And it will all be done. And the kingdom will be restored. And we will rule and reign with Christ on this earth. Seven mountains will diminish, and one big king named Jesus will take its place.
Amen. Amen. Wow. So can you then just pray an impartation for the listeners? Just do a blessing over them. In the Old Testament, as you know, Wesley studied the blessing so much.
Yeah.
And the priests were commanded, say to the people, say it out loud. You know, speak it over them. There's something in the articulation of the blessing and the impartation. And do you have any final thoughts before you do that? Because I do want you to really release that.
I think it's time to really bless the people. And God is a God who blesses His sons and daughters. If you read the book of Genesis, 88 times you have the word bless or blessing or a derivation of that word. It begins at the beginning. The blessing of God is forevermore. So I will bless you as the priest of my family, as the minister of the gospel, and as a lover of God. I want to just bless each one right now. So listen up, open your heart. I bless you with a heart to pursue God with passion, with fire, with longings that move you past status quo and grip you night and day to pray, to seek his face, and to persevere. I bless you with a heart that will not give up when pain surrounds you, when disappointments multiply, when delay is on top of delay. I bless you with that never quit attitude. By God's grace, you will endure all things. I bless you with a heart for your family, your marriage, your children and grandchildren, the people who matter most to you. I bless you with an intense increase of that love. May it manifest this day in unusual ways. And I bless you with an increasing love for the scriptures, a devouring hunger, insatiable, that when others malign you for your faith, you will turn back to the word of God and find your hope and find your joy and find your peace again in the scriptures. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. May he bless you with long life, angelic presence, loving relationships, and a passion to fulfill his plan for your life. May the Lord bless you and keep you, my friend, in the very name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Now, those of you who just heard that blessing, you need to rewind that and play it over yourself. You need to put it on repeat. And as you lie down, as you get up, you just need to have that blessing in your ears. And I thank you, Brian. That was beautiful and just so confirming of the things that God has been speaking to so many prophets and leaders and people. And I feel like you've brought somehow today a depth, maybe just from coming out of that life-death experience, but an even deeper burning for those things that God is speaking, a deeper desire. It's arousing desire and longing for it. And so I just want to thank you very, very much. And can you please tell people how to find out more about your ministry and where they can get the Passion Translation? And, you know, you have the whole New Testament completed, but not quite the whole Bible yet. So they can buy a New Testament or they can buy book by book. How do they do it?
Well, yeah, I suggest you get the New Testament. You can find that any bookstore or Amazon or even on our website, which is passionandfire.com, passionandfire.com. But yeah, we have Genesis, Isaiah, Joshua, Judges, and Ruth is being released as I speak. So Courage to Conquer is the subtitle. Jeremiah and Lamentations will be out by next year. I've finished it. It's in the editing stage. And Ezekiel is finished, and I'm about to complete Daniel by the month of April. Well, I don't know when this will air, but in the month of April, I will start, God willing, the book of Hosea.
Incredible. Well, we are so glad God kept you, walked you through the valley of the shadow of death, and now you can finish the whole Bible translation. We all need it and anticipate every book when it's out. So thank you so much, dear friends, and bless you and keep you. Amen.
Thank you. Bye-bye.